Much that once was is lost, for none now live who remember it.
The One Ring had come to Rivendell, and the Fellowship was formed to destroy it. As they set out for Mount Doom, the forces of darkness rise. Not yet at war, they are nevertheless forming armies to destroy the free cities of men, elves, and dwarves. Welcome to our playthrough of War of the Ring. In it, the Free People's player will be trying to destroy the One Ring, or take 4 points worth of settlements from the forces of darkness. The forces of darkness, meanwhile, will be trying to take 10 points worth of settlements from the Free Peoples, or corrupt Frodo enough that he joins with them and gives them the One Ring. Anything can happen based on the choices of the players. Who will triumph is anyone's guess. Leading the Fellowship is Gandalf the Grey. He leads them out of Rivendell just as his old friend Saruman the White pushes Isengard to war, setting himself up in Orthanc. Sauron follows by leading Mordor to war. Faramir's rangers snipe at the gathering armies of Mordor and back up into Osgiliath. A ringwraith flies near Rivendell to search for the Fellowship, but they slip past it, getting 3 spaces, which could put them as far as the Goblin's Gate where a ringwraith has just moved to, or even Moria, where the Balrog has just climbed up from its deep pit. This abomination has driven the elves to war. The Eye of Sauron is now searching heavily for the ring, and the Fellowship takes a risk anyway. Its risk pays off, and they manage to slip past the hunters yet again. The company is feeling so confident that they separate, sending 2 of the companions off to rally their people. Legolas takes Gimli to his woodland realm, where he joins his fellow elves rallying for war. Gimli continues on to Eberron and rallies the dwarves to war. The Fellowship moves again, appearing in Lothlorien. However, their path crossed the Balrog, and in the search for them, they were found as they passed through Moria. The great demon caught Gandalf in his whip, and he fell into darkness with it. Galadriel appeared in Lothlorien, and she took Frodo to her mirror. It did not do much for lowering his corruption, but it did show him that Gothmog had appeared at the borders of Mordor, and the Witch King in Dol Guldur, ready to lead armies against them. The elves then gave the members of the Fellowship elven cloaks and sent them on their way. The forces of darkness were now on the move. The hillmen of Dunland joined Saruman, prepared to help him. The forces of Mordor moved out of their borders, and the Witch King moved back to his home in Angmar, where he raised an army, prepared to attack from the north. The dwarves had now gathered, and they marched on North Rûn against the Easterlings, who had rallied to Sauron's call. They assaulted, taking few casualties while destroying 3/4 of the Easterlings' army and flinging the remainder into East Rûn. The Easterlings reinforced with their Momenkil and men, and they met on the fields of East Rûn, where a mighty battle was engaged for the fate of the East. The elite units of the Easterlings were taken down as the mighty Momenkils fell with roars of despair. After losing the backbone of their army, they retreated into South Rûn, where a ringwraith met them to lead the forces in their final defense. The dwarves pressed their assault, and the final battle versus the Easterlings was met. The dwarves took down 2 units of Easterlings, losing an elite unit themselves, and the king of the dwarves fell with them. As he did, he passed his leadership on to Gimli, for him to continue the fight in his stead. Gimli led a mighty charge, losing only 1 more unit to destroy the remainder of the Easterlings and the ringwraith who led them. The dwarves were victorious, taking the East for themselves. Concerned about this threat, Sauron moved an entire army onto the Ash Mountain to contain the dwarves. Recognizing the danger, Gimli pulled back into a defensive position. Gandalf, having defeated the Balrog and returned from the deepest places of the earth, showed up in Fangorn and learned of Sauron's growing forces in Isengard. He informed another friend, Treebeard, a shepherd of the forest, whose anger at Sauron knew no bounds. He began to raise up the treants of Fangorn to march on Orthanc. The Fellowship, meanwhile, moved past them into the Eastumnet. They were making good time and had only garnered 1 point of corruption, so the Free Peoples were feeling confident. The forces of darkness, meanwhile, wanted that ring found, and Sauron sent his eyes out everywhere to find it. Spiders spread throughout the Eastumnet to find them, managing to reveal them and forcing Frodo to wear the ring again. The corsairs of Umbar transported troops of the Southrons past Pelagir and took Lamedon, cutting the land of Gondor in two. The Southrons then gathered along the Anduin River, then crossed it to besiege Pelagir. Invading the city, they laid waste to it and all who were inside. Boromir left the Fellowship and arrived in Minas Tirith to lead the defense of the White City. Strider also left the Fellowship, hurrying to Edoras. There, he drove them to action, at least insofar as to prepare for war. From there, Strider found a path through the mountains to speak with the dead men of Dom Harrow. He promised their spirits that he would free them from their spectral limbo if they would fight for him. They agreed, and exited the mountain in Eric with their king. The Southrons were continuing their advance westward, laying siege to Dol Amroth, where the men inside felt little hope of survival. Then, from the horizon, a spectral tide appeared rolling down the mountains. They consumed the Southrons, killing hordes of them and causing the rest to retreat. Now, with only the hobbits remaining in the Fellowship, Merry and Pippin left and went west to draw off the Nazgul, while Frodo and Sam went east into the western Imin Muil. There they were set upon by Gollum, but they overcame him and forced him to be their guide. They would need to move fast, for the forces of darkness were on the move, and would soon be invading the heart of the Free People's lands. Saruman, for one, had raised the hillmen to fight for him. Strider, meanwhile, had built up the army of the dead and led them against the Southrons, currently at Pelagir. There they wiped out nearly half the remainder of their army and flung them back across the Anduin. It was of little concern to Sauron, however, as Gothmog was gathering giant spiders to his hordes while the forces of Dol Guldur moved northward. They were joined by more Nazgul, who flew over their forces. Those in Mirkwood continued north until they reached the Woodland Realm. There they assaulted the woodland fortress in which the elves defended, including Legolas. The spiders spun webs throughout the branches while the elves retreated further up the trees as they fought. The fight was valiant, with the elves scraping many orcs off the trees as they approached, but many of the elves were falling as well. Legolas fired steadily, hopping from branch to branch, each arrow finding its mark. But then, as though a burst of energy coursed through the orcs, goblins, trolls, and spiders, they raced up every tree trunk, shaking out every elf like acorns to the ground, where they were massacred in droves. Even Legolas was not spared. The defeat was complete, and the forces of darkness held the woodland realm by day's end. Seeing what was happening in the woods across from them, the Ents realized that it was time to move, and they meandered out onto the fords of Isen. But they were so slow that they took no more action for a time. The army of darkness that had taken Mirkwood now turned eastward and invaded Dale. The men there hid behind the walls of their city, and a siege began. The army of the dead spent, Strider finally entered Minas Tirith. There he was pronounced King Aragorn, and he rallied his troops to defend the oncoming horde led by Gothmog, who had Faramir's forces holed up in Osgiliath. Frodo knew that time was running thin, and he had to move despite the dangers. The Eye of Sauron settled on him, but Galadriel distracted Sauron with her own ring, Nenya. Nevertheless, they were spotted by evil forces, and Frodo was again forced to wear the ring. His corruption was getting serious now, halfway to being overtaken by evil. The shadow lengthened far to the west, where the Witch King had now made himself known in Angmar, and he led his forces southward. But Tom Bombadil protected his own area, and neither the Shire nor the Old Forest could be touched. So the Witch King turned westward into the Grey Havens. There they stormed the walls and attacked, slaughtering many of the elves while taking few casualties, until they had taken the port. Now no elves would be able to escape Middle-earth. All were trapped in the continent. Merry and Pippin arrived in Fangorn, where they were introduced to the trees by Gandalf, who then had to ride off very quickly on his steed Shadowfax to the south, into Edoras. There he brought them to war so they would protect themselves against Saruman. Now every faction was at war, fighting for the freedom, or subjugation, of Middle-earth. The Eagles were now drawn into the conflict, and they sent some of their own to help move the ring. So there, all you folks complaining that the Eagles should have flown the ring to Mount Doom can feel satisfied now, even though it doesn't make any sense. Okay, to put this argument to rest once and for all, the Eagles could not carry the ring, or even the ring bearer, to Mordor, because the ring corrupts those around it. It would certainly have corrupted an eagle's mind, which would have then dropped the ring bearer from 10,000 feet, flat hobbit, and they'd pick up the ring and take it straight to Sauron. I guess the creators of the game never thought of that, but there you go. You got your card. Be happy. Okay, so Frodo is coming out of the Dead Marshes, presumably into North Ithilien. Which direction he will go from there is anyone's guess. Aragorn builds up his army, and Sauron builds up his. And to get an idea of how much the forces of darkness outnumbered the Free Peoples, Aragorn transferred a regular unit into an elite unit, and Sauron raised 5 regular units and a Nazgul and Minas Morgul. Gandalf is doing all he can to counter this imbalance by raising forces in Edoras. The Tree Ents do their part as well, attacking from the Fords of Isen to destroy 2 elite units and 1 regular unit guarding Orthanc. Saruman had spent so much time building that army, and now he would have to start from scratch. In a desperate attempt to keep the Ringbearer out of Mordor, one of the Nazgul is dispatched to the Fellowship's last known location. Despite this, Frodo, Sam, and Smeagol are able to once again slip out of their grasp and begin climbing the mountain toward the Crack of Doom. The time has come for the Great Battle of Minas Tirith. All of Sauron's forces that had been building up nearby came out, and the Free Peoples holed up inside the walls of the stronghold. While Saruman began rebuilding his forces, the dwarves spotted a weakness. The Woodland Realm had been left empty, so they rushed in. Never had the dwarves thought that they would actually take the elven stronghold, but here they were, stepping over the bodies of the slain. Frodo, Sam, and Smeagol continued slowly up the mountain, taking more and more corruption. With only 1 point of corruption remaining before he turned, Frodo did not believe they would make it. To make matters worse, the forces of Isengard invaded Rohan. They might have assaulted the men who were in hiding, but the Treants struck again, this time taking out 2 units. Then, with all the Forces of Darkness units gone from the Fords of Isen, the Ents were able to march on Orthanc. With no one there to defend him, Saruman had no choice but to retreat deep within his tower, never to be released again on the world. His forces were still loose, however, and they assaulted Helm's Deep, taking heavy damage to kill off 1 remaining unit inside the fortress. They had now taken 5 points worth of fortresses and cities. They were halfway to victory. Sauron tried to lengthen this lead by making an onslaught on Minas Tirith, where Aragorn, Boromir, and their men made a brave stand. They lost elite men, but the orcs lost many of their minions. The orcs came again in a desperate attempt to take the city, and Aragorn shouted no quarter, and the result was the loss of more elite knights and standard soldiers as well, while killing quite a number of spiders. The forces of darkness came at them one last time. The eagles came to help by fighting off the Nazgul, while the spiders came at them with incredible speed. The result was some of the men defending one of the walls being devoured by giant spiders. An unpleasant time for them, but for others, not much action. They pressed the attack, and both sides again lost lightly. The good news for Gondor was that, while their numbers were dwindling, Sauron's forces were dwindling as well, and they were unable to launch another attack without the risk of being annihilated. And so they called for help. And their call was answered by the mouth of Sauron, who had with him an army in Minas Morgul. He let the shadows grow long in the evening, and with it, they transported themselves to Minas Tirith to reinforce the army. Frodo needed to move forward, even at the risk of losing his mind. His courage paid off, as did his and Sam's elven cloaks, which kept them concealed from the eye of Sauron. Still, he had 2 spaces to go and 1 point of leeway. It was uncertain whether he would make it, and going right away would be risky. As Frodo and Sam moved cautiously, the forces of darkness moved on Erebor, charging with an onslaught and killing the dwarves in their mountain fortress with only 1 unit of the enemy still alive. Despite the diminutive number, they had won the homeland of the dwarves, and they were creeping ahead on the victory track. Only 3 points of settlements to go. Gandalf moved the army of Edoras out into the west of Net.
Ride out and meet him head on.
Saruman's forces in Helm's Deep braced for an attack, but then, realizing Gandalf's forces could go take Orthanc instead, they rode out to meet them, causing only damage to their hillmen. The mouth of Sauron, meanwhile, assaulted Minas Tirith with his great host. Aragorn and Boromir put up a daring defense side by side, thus canceling out the numbers with the great host. This caused the casualties to be low, which bought Frodo a little more time. The fight continued, with both sides worn out of their command tricks. It became a brutal melee to the death everywhere throughout the city. The Gondorians first wiped out the giant bugs. They then traded 1 of their elite units for 2 regulars of the orcs. They then had a mighty defense in which they destroyed 4 units without taking a single loss. the city had held for one more day. That would hopefully give Frodo the time he needed to get to the crack of doom. Aragorn took that moment of respite to make one last attempt to distract Sauron. Picking up the Palantir, he made a challenge to the Lord of Darkness. He would draw three tiles. If Aragorn drew three eyes, he would be eliminated. If he drew anything else, the drawn eye tiles would be eliminated, thus helping Frodo, as those tiles would cause more corruption if Frodo tried to move fast through Mordor. Aragorn drew the hunt tiles. He drew one eye. He drew a second eye. One more eye, and Aragorn would fall down dead. He drew a zero. The two eyes were discarded, and the zero went back into the bag. Frodo just might have a chance. Frodo used the distraction to move closer. He drew the tile. Smeagol helped him find his way. Corruption was reduced by one. He was now three spaces away from full corruption, and one space away from the crack of doom. Frodo was likely to make it. The forces of darkness needed to win quickly. They did so by attacking Gandalf, but he defended with equal losses. They pressed their attack, and the Rohirrim destroyed them. Then Gandalf sent one unit in to free Helm's Deep, while he marched the rest of the forces into Isengard. They surrounded Orthanc and took the tower for their own. Elves returned to the Woodland Realm, and they marched side by side with the dwarves to help them take back their homeland of Erebor. There, they destroyed the army of evil and slew the Ringwraith. All was going well for the Free Peoples. In Minas Tirith, Gothmog and the Mouth of Sauron made one last desperate attack upon the walls of the city. They crawled up over the walls, and the Nazgul swept down upon them, decimating the defenders. Though they made a valiant defense once again, destroying nearly all the attackers, the defenders of Minas Tirith were at last overcome. Boromir, Captain of the West, and Aragorn, King of Gondor, were slain upon the field. But their sacrifice would not be in vain. Frodo entered the Crack of Doom and approached the Pit of Fire. Both Smeagol and Sam had helped him get there. It was time to destroy the Ring of Power and all evil along with it. They only needed to draw one last tile. It was a three. Exactly what was needed to corrupt him.
The ring is mine.
And so Frodo turned evil. He joined with Sauron, and with his ring back, Sauron was once again able to cover all the lands in darkness. All were subjugated to his power. Except the Old Forest and the Shire. They were under the protection of Tom Bombadil. Yep, this weirdo is the only one keeping anyone free of Sauron's hate. So the hobbits and he are all singing and rolling naked in the grass while the world burns outside their borders. A happy ending indeed. I hope you all enjoyed it. Subscribe to see more game videos, and happy gaming, everybody.